Good morning to our West Africa colleagues and good morning to everybody else. Welcome to another webinar, which is part of the AGRA Knowledge Management Learning Sessions. Today's presentation will be from PID on inclusive finance. We continue to make AGRA a learning institution by ensuring that we continue to learn from each other, what we do, how we do it, and the effect this has on the smallholder farmers, SMEs, and other stakeholders. As we did last time, kindly type your questions at any time in the Q&A panel. Join me in welcoming Dr. Rufaro Madakadze, who will be our moderator for this session. Over to you, Rufaro.
Good morning, West Africa, and good afternoon, East and Southern Africa. As Jane has said, this is our second webinar this year in AGRA. This is also the first webinar from the PID team, learning on inclusive finance, how this works on the ground. This is one of the first of about seven webinars that the PID team would like is rolling out to ensure that AGRA learns and knows what happens on the ground. Our presenters are Hedwig Swetson and Aurelia Dakpokan, who are starting just now. Thank you very much. Enjoy.
Good morning, West Africa. Good afternoon, colleagues in East Africa. Welcome to the first Inclusive Finance webinar. I mean, we would like to do more because we do much more than input finance. But let's start with the first topic of today, which is input finance. Let me take you through the presentation, the program we are hosting today. We'll start with an introduction to explain to you how the inclusive finance system fits together. What are we all doing? We are seven colleagues in the unit. We are all doing different parts of the inclusive finance system. So I will talk to that so that you can position where the input finance model fits. Then Aurelia will take you through the input finance model, after which we will explain to you how you can engage and how you can make this input finance model work within your own country and within your own work. After which we will present a case study, and then Rufaro will start to do the Q&A. But as Jane already announced, you can already post your questions as we go along in the Q&A box, so that we have a rolling conversation together with you. So let me first introduce where the inclusive finance system sits that we are going to discuss today. We have three types of systems in inclusive finance. If you read this picture from left to right, we will start at our left and we will see government and DFIs. Government and DFIs are the people that have cheap money that can be made available to decrease the risk and the cost of finance. An example is Profit in Kenya, an example is Girzal in Ghana, an example is Rufip in Ethiopia. This body of work, so to make sure that DFIs and governments invest in making access to finance cheaper for banks, that's the work of Eze. He will get another webinar to explain what he does and how it works. Then in the middle system, so the middle green round circle, you'll have the inclusive finance system that we are going to talk about today, which is getting money from banks into SMEs, hands, and rural financial institutions. That's body of work, we call that value chain finance. Today we're going to present one of the things that one of the elements of the value chain finance system, which is input finance. On the right hand side, you can see how agriculture SMEs and rural financial institutions make money and finance solutions available for farmers. In order to reduce cost and risk over there, we mainly promote digital solutions. That's the body of work that we are doing within FISFAP, where Edward, Ruben and Pakwezi are working. Sorry, I forgot to mention in the middle system, Alfred is also in charge of SME finance. So that is a bit how we have divided our work. So as said, today we're going to talk about input finance, which is how can we make sure that farmers get access to inputs through the companies and through banks. Over to Aurelia. Aurelia, what are the current ways that inputs are being financed? If I'm a farmer, I want to plant, I want to buy hybrid seeds. How do I get access to inputs? How is that being done currently? And what are the issues that it's not working and that we have developed new solutions because things are not working the way they should? Over to you.
Thank you very much, Edwige. You are asking a very great question. First, just let me greet the attendees and also the team that make possible this webinar. I'm Aurelia Dakougan, based in Burkina Faso and in charge of inclusive finance activity in Burkina and Mali. So, like I was saying, your question is very, very interesting, and I think it's also an actual question because in most countries, farmers are currently struggling to access finance. But in the field, what happens most of the time? Let me use the visual here to explain to you a little bit how the system works and what we observe in the field as challenge when farmers is accessing finance. So most of the time we find the farmer here in the field between an input access and an output offer. So they are linked to some agro dealers, to some input supplier that need to provide them with input. They will produce and supply another market. But there also we have the finance, which is key because the finance, I can say, is the most important input because it enables the quantity and the quality of input needed for farmers to really increase the productivity and offer in the market so good products. So if the farmer business succeed, I mean, they have good quality of input, produce a lot, the output buyer is benefiting because you receive quality products. The input buyer will sell more produce next time and the bank also will have back his money. In case the farmer's business fail, the same failure will affect the related business. So there is a great relationship between the farmer business and the other SME participants in the value chain businesses. But when is it, it's time for farmer to have access to those inputs, most of the time, he is only facing the challenging to access this loan, or the outbuyer can be facing it on his behalf, or the bank will also facing it on his behalf. But when it's time also say everybody is benefiting. So it's not really a great situation for the farmer. Most of the time we saw them carrying a very high risk of loan, a very higher requirement. They don't have collateral. They don't have enough data to provide the bank to lower the cost of financing. And at the end of the day, those of them that were able to access the finance, they end up with very low margin, or next time they are excluded because they were not able to pay back the loan. And in other cases, we can see the out buyer, when they saw that the smallholder farmer can access the input, they took it as a responsibility to offer them the input. So in some community, you can see the buyer or the input supplier providing loan, input loan to the farmers, but it's not really their job. And when it happened most of the time, it ended up with the buyer who doesn't have another more possibility to expand his businesses because it's affecting the fund he's supposed to use for his business. Most of the time is they end up with low margin, they can't expand the business, or they are the power doesn't have enough they face directly the financing on behalf of the farmers, but they can't do it at large scale because the risk is higher. They limit their exposure and then they can't finance. So the complaint is most of the time we submit, you see the smallholder farmers complaining, we submit so many loan requests, but we were able to just have few finance. So it's very important to have the loan risk share between all the SMEs or all the VC participants to be able to have a sustainable input finance system in the field. Back to you, Edwin.
Thank you, Aurelia. I'm not sure whether everybody had a bit of technical hiccups, but what I gather from your presentation is I see four parties benefit when the production is being good, right? The farmers benefit, the input dealers benefit, the off-takers benefit, and the banks are benefiting. So four parties benefit from the fact that more produce is being produced and improved inputs are being invested in. What I see when it comes to financing is that in most cases, there's only one or two parties that take all of the risk. If we look in the first case that you presented, where the farmer takes a loan, it's only a transaction between the farmer and the bank. The input dealer or the off-taker doesn't take any risk in the financing. While they get the benefits because they sell more seeds and they get good produce. In the second scenario, where the SMEs take all of the risk to give inputs to the farmers at their own balance sheet, I mean, we can see that that is definitely not the work of the SME, and it goes at the detriment of their own business, which is not what we want. We want to grow SMEs. We don't want SMEs to turn into banks. In the last scenario you presented, where the bank gives the credit, I mean, the banks can only do so much because the risk is very high that smallholders fail in paying. So that's why the availability of input finance is restricted. So I think I get your point, right? I think the benefit is for everybody, while only one or two people are taking all of the risk of financing the improved inputs we are promoting. So now, what have you done to solve this solution? Because we have been hearing a lot about this input finance model from all kinds of corners. So present to us how it's working and how does it respond to the issues we have just presented. Over to you.
Thank you, Edwige. So what we do is to try to set up a model where all the businesses partner can share the loan risk. And in the field, this is exactly how it works. So we have the four parties, I say the farmers group, the buyer, the input supplier, and the bank, who need to work together to enable the farmer to access inputs. So the first things that has been done is to set up, I can say, the legal framework of this system. And it's composed of a general partnership agreement involving the four partners. This one is like a constitution of the system. And it involves also a guarantee purchase contract between directly the buyer and the farmer, and then a loan agreement between the farmer and the bank. But what is unique with this model, and you can find in other input finance model, is that this general partnership agreement have a risk structure, a component, which is made in two parts. First, before the disbursement, the buyer agreed to make a deposit of at least 10% with the bank. I mean, 10% of the input amount requested by the farmer. And then the farmer themselves also agreed to make a deposit of at least 10% of the amount of loan they are requesting. And since the bank have those, I mean, deposits in his account, and the different loan or the different agreement has been signed, the bank now made a partial payment to the input supplier and asked the input supplier to deliver the input to the farmers. So it's a no cash disbursement. All the farmer received directly the input, and this also reduced the diversion of the loan bank are facing sometimes in rural area. But you can see here that it is a partial payment, a maximum of 90% of the input, total input cost they has delivered. So then the second part of the risk sharing structure come in, where the bank holds the supplier payment at least 10% to enable him also to participate to this risk sharing structure. And at the end of the day, when the farmer use the inputs produced, they deliver the harvest to the buyer, and the buyer pay back the loan. As soon as the bank receives the full repayment of the loan, then he releases the different deposits of the farmer, of the buyer, and he pay back the remaining amount for the input supplier, and the system is, the cycle of financing is finished. They can restart next time and say, no, we don't want to withdraw our deposit. We want to keep there and increase it for the next cycle of loan. It's up to the four participants to decide. But the system has revealed that they have not used any other external guarantee fund to enable access to this one. It's not a guarantee fund for a project that may end up in debt withdrawal and the system collapse. They are able to raise themselves the collateral needed, the cash collateral needed to make the system work. Thank Edwige, back to you.
Okay, if we look at this picture, I think at least I can see everybody is sharing risk, right? So I think the buyer, because they put a deposit in the bank of 10%. So if the crop is failing, then the buyer loses 10%. The input supplier also loses when the crop fails, because they've only received 90% payments of the inputs they got. And the farmers also lose their 10% when the crop is failing. So the bank only has a risk cover of 70% maximum, right? And I think we put minimum so that in some cases, buyers would maybe deposit more money. Now, if I look at this, and if I'm a buyer, I mean, why would I do this? I mean, why would I put 10% or 20% money in a bank in a cash deposit to make sure that a farmer gets inputs? And as an input supplier, why would I accept to only get 90% of the input value being paid, right? And as a farmer, why would I deposit money in the bank if I need money to buy inputs? So maybe you can talk us a bit through what are the benefits for each of these parties by participating in this, because I'm sure you have been talking to all of these parties to make sure these contracts are being signed. So what are your arguments, right? How do you convince people that this is a good scheme for them? Over to you.
Thank Edwige. I can notice that you are asking the very, very high questions. This is the most challenging part when we are implementing this model. And as all of the actors are in business, there is no free engagement or engagement without any benefits. So what are really the benefits and what motivates the different parties to get into this model? Believe me, they are not doing it for free. They need to see the opportunity cost. They also need to see really what are the advantages. So when I take, for instance, the bank, this model have revealed that they can lower the operational cost in the field, because if they were used to go farmer by farmer, assess the land, define themselves what quantity of input they have to finance, it's really costly. And some of them are not even close to the farmers, unless we have the microfinance and the credit union, but most of them are in town. So it's very costly. But with this model, they have the avenue to directly have the information from the farmer group or from the buyer or the input supplier that are already in relationship with those farmers. Another very important aspect for banks is they can now share the loan risk with the farmers, because at farmer level, they don't have any collateral, they don't have assets. The things they can offer you, maybe the cow, the land without title, and those guarantees are not really tangible on bank side. It's not easy for them to realize those guarantees and cover the loan in case of default. So having there some cash deposits they may be using in case of default, make it very easy for them to enter into agric finance. And also they have the opportunity to sell other products to the farmers. When I take the cases in Ghana, the bank used the opportunity, for instance, to sell savings loan products to the farmers. So collect deposits and also finance the SME related to those farmers to enable them also to have more flow entering into the mechanism. So this for bank is really an interesting model that can help them to expand their portfolio, reduce the risks and the costs. On farmer side, we can see that they are able now to have a guarantee market because everything starts from there. Contract with the market and even the buyer make a deposit to enable them to access loan. So the commitment is very high and they are sure that this market will help them to pay back the loan. Another thing is that the farmer group, the leaders have more voice with the management of their farmer because they can offer them financial services, financial autonomy. They can offer them inputs. And also it makes viable a little bit those farmer group organizations in the fields. And the last point is the lower the price of the loan, because since they are sharing the risk with the bank, one component of the interest rate, which is made of the risk, is lower. And within our implementation system, we see some banks who taking into account and lower the interest rate for bank for farmers. And the last participants, which are really the person we need to convince a lot to enter this mechanism because they don't see it before, they don't do business this way before, is the input supplier or the off-taker. And the input supplier at time, you see that they have very low margin in their produce. They will ask you, why should I enter into this system? You see that the input I'm selling, the margin is very low. How can I do it? And one time we are doing it, I think it's in Ghana. And what happened is the input supplier say, well, if you want me to share the loan risk, what I'll do is to just increase the cost of the input. So I know that you put a hold on my payments, but at the end of the day, if I don't receive it, fine, because I have already increased the price. So we may be facing some challenges like this, but what we ask them is transparency. And the first benefits they are receiving, if they were into pre-financing the farmer, they can direct now these funds to other purpose. Assuming that they used to provide $1,000 to pre-finance 100 farmers at 100%. And we say, now you are no more pre-financing at 100%. Use this $1,000 to pre-finance, let's say, 200 farmers at 30% or at 50%. They are expanding the network. It may be the procurement network, it may be the selling, the customer, the selling network. And also, for them, they are into guaranteed supply of produce. They can have a voice on the input the farmer may be using, the quality of seed, the variety of seed they may be using, the good agricultural practice they may follow to fulfill, to respect the market demand the output buyer is having. So they have the control throughout the chain, throughout from the production till the market side. And I think very processors are interested to enter into the system because it's not their job to organize the production. It's not their job to do the role bank. And this system offers really the opportunity to solve this problem. Back to you, Edwige. I hope I clarify a bit your worry about these questions.
I think I can see it, right? And I think it depends a bit on how things are being done now, because it's true. Eh? We've seen agro dealers that pre-finance 100% of the inputs for farmers to buy. Seed companies, for example, often run into problems because they give their products on credit. So yeah, I can clearly see that by sharing the risk, everybody gains a bit, right? So that is, I can see it clear. So now maybe let's see what it means for Agra and for all of our listeners. What can you do if we want to do and implement this input finance model? Because it didn't fall from the air. I think it all started by the notion that we have been organizing consortia or agribusiness platforms, as the word was introduced last week in the webinar. I think this agribusiness platforms, consortia, that many of you are engaged in, is an ideal departure situation for implementation of this input finance model, because people need to know each other, they need to work together. And I think this agribusiness platform or consortia that we actually have, they have already had several seasons working together. So I think that's the ideal entry point for us in Agra to start trying to implement this model. So we need to have these two parties you see on the screen. So the number two is the value chain actors. That's the people you're already working with in your consortia. That's the input dealers, the seed companies, the off-takers, the processors, and the farmer groups. So those people you already know. So tell us, us in Inclusive Finance, which setups you see fit for implementing this model. So where do you see where input dealers, processors and farmers want to work together and trust each other by bringing in a financial institution who can then take over the financial function? Because now in most cases, finance is being done within those value chain actors. What we want is that the bank plays the role of the financier, so that SMEs can use their working capital to invest in their business instead of pre-financing farmers. So if you tell us who the number twos, the value chain actors, the consortia are that you see fit for implementing this model, then we as the Inclusive Finance team will help you to identify the financial services providers that would be interested to make this model work and to could make sure more money is being invested in this model. And then we will support you to negotiate the contracts. All the templates are already there. We have the contracts already drafted, so we can help you to implement this model in your country. So please reach out to us if you're interested, if you see how this can work in your consortia, and reach out to us, and then we will introduce the bank. Or maybe you have already identified the bank, right? The one that is already near to where the farmers and the businesses are. And then we will help you to negotiate the contracts with the bank and to explain the model. Now, I think you all want to know, like, is this dreaming? Is this theoretical study room stuff that Aurelia and Hedwig has been inventing? Well, I have news for you. This has already been done. It has already been tried. So we want to finish this by presenting to you some cases where this has been working. So if you are interested to see it work, once we can travel again, we invite you to come and see how it works in the countries that we have already been piloting. Over to you, Aurelia, to present briefly the three cases we already have.
Yes, as you said, we already have three cases, specifically in Ghana, in Mali, and in Burkina. And we have surely more detail on the context and how this was implemented in the three countries through the PowerPoint down here. But what I want to emphasize is when you look at the three countries, the context is not the same in all of them. So we look at really the context to see who will be the entry point. The entry point may be the bank, or the entry point may be the farmer group we have in our community. With Ghana, we end with a microfinance bank called Advance, who were really open to develop the model and then design a product. I mean, they design a loan product, and now, based on this product, they were able to have scenarios and engage the value chain participants here to the model. So they were able to tell the participants here, this is our products. If you share the risk up to 50%, this is the interest rate we'll be offering to your farmer on the input loan. And if you don't share it, this is, so they were able to make some simulation and make it really attractive for value chain participants to get in. But in Mali and Burkina, we don't have this opportunity. So what we do is to go through directly the farmer group in those countries. So this is really where our work in the consortia help a lot, because in the consortia, we have already some innovation introduced into on the input side, and farmers are eager to test them. We have some inputs, the agro dealer input supplier connected to the consortia. We have some buyer already took formal or non-formal contracts receiving farmers' products. So we use this framework to engage the farmer and enable them to present to the banks a value proposition of what they are doing in the consortia. So the discussion becomes, we are in a consortia, this is the different actors, we come with this risk share to access loan, so what are you offering us as loan offer? So this is how it's we enter the system in Mali. And so far in the four countries, we have a quite great disbursement of loan for a pilot stage. And then in Ghana, we have 100 reimbursements, so no default. In Mali as well, we have zero default on this loan. And in Burkina, they are still paying and the loan is now due in for June 2020. So depending on the context you have on your country side, we will help you to see the entry point because the selection of the partner is key for the success of this model. So thank you very much, Edwige. Back to you.
Thank you, Aurelia, for taking us through this model. The one last point we want to make is that some of the banks might be hesitant to do this, right? There's because it's all about costs and risk. I already saw somebody mentioning that. So that's why we have the other bodies of work in inclusive finance, right? So if the bank is still hesitant, we can still offer them the guarantee facility that we have in many countries. Like Girzal is giving a guarantee to Advanced Bank. You see here the first bank that Aurelia gave the example of is Advanced Bank. Advanced Bank, so they are also qualified for Girzal. So if they need additional risk coverage, they can get that from Girzal, a 50% risk. So to even reduce the risk more and share with another party. Another instrument we are working on in several countries is insurance, because if the crop fails, who is going to pay? I mean, we've seen that many people, that all of them lose a bit, right? But it might still be too much for the bank to lose 70 or 60%. So they might ask for an insurance scheme. So that's another element we need to work on as inclusive finance, and in fact, all of us. The last one is the cost of getting finance to farmers. How do we interact with farmers? Farmers are far, they disperse, they are all over the place. So that's what FISFAP is doing. FISFAP is trying to reach farmers through their phones, so that we don't need to set up physical branches of banks in order to make payments to farmers. So that is the three links. And like, for example, Advanced Bank, again, they're also a partner of FISFAP to make sure that mobile payments and mobile money works for the farmers they are working with. So in fact, Advanced Bank in Ghana is having all of the three bodies of work of inclusive finance. So if you want to understand what we do, go and visit Advanced Bank and see what they do. This was our presentation. I am now inviting Rufaro to take us through the questions and clarifications that the colleagues have been asking. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. There are a few questions here for us. I think we will start with the question by Tadele, who says it seems that it seems from your presentation that risk is the biggest issue in agriculture. May I, and especially in availing finance, may I ask what the primary risks are in agriculture and what are the institutions that are best fit to underwrite those risks? I heard you a bit talking about some of this risk. May you explain a little more for Tadele and all of us?
Did you ask it to me, Rufaro, because I mentioned
to Aurelia.
Aurelia, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Tadele, for the questions. Yeah, when you look at most of the time, the agri system, the main risks are related most of the time to the climate risk we have. Severe drought, floods, and also disease, pest. Or we may also have the price volatility on the market side. So there are other risks related to the production or to the selling of produce. But in finance also, all those risks are integrated when we are looking at finance, because the banker will look at all this and then will look at also the risk of not having back the money he will be lending. So I think there are so many categories of risk. The primary are mainly related to the production, the markets, but we need also to integrate them when we are looking at the finance. Edwige, I don't know, you may have something to add to these questions.
No, I think you've laid it out well, right? So it depends a bit on the country, right? In some countries, it's price volatility informed by government interference in buying or not buying, or setting prices or not setting prices. Of course, there's a lot of risk, right? And I think we're not saying that there will be no risks, and banks are there to take risks. What we try to do is to make the risks acceptable to all of the parties involved. And as we said in the beginning, sometimes parties take all of the risk, right? The input dealer that gives the seats on credit for 100% at his own or her own risk, right? So that is what we try to avoid by having this model, that we are, that they are all the parties involved are all losing if something goes wrong. I think that is the main purpose of this model. It's to share the risk and not having one shoulder carrying all of the risk.
Thank you very much.
May I add something to the risk?
Okay, yes, please.
Okay.
Yeah, they're also perceived risks, which are as a function of the fact that all the players do not understand what others are doing. There is information gaps. So when you have a model like this, you create a platform through which everybody is able to see the transactions, mm-hmm. and therefore you reduce the risks by giving adequate information for them to make decisions. So those perceived risks then go away because they understand very well that if it is this particular value chain, this is how it works. And this is how the cash flow moves in that value chain. And therefore, a financier would be saying, this is my starting point. If I finance from this point of view, I see that the value chain is going to have this cash flow, and therefore, I'll be able to recover my money. So that's another area of cost reduction in terms of risk reduction in terms of providing adequate information.
Thank you very much, Ezra. Thank you. Transparency is, I think, key in all these financial dealings. The second question was from Ones Karuo. He says, where does 90% come from? Please repeat. I can see 10% from farmers, 10% from off-takers. So where is all the other risk coming from?
I guess it's for me. Let me go back to the description of the model to explain a little bit how the risk is shared. I hope it will answer honest questions. So the structure is, we expect the smallholder farmer to make at least 10% deposit. We just put at least, because in, for instance, the case of Ghana and Mali, no, Ghana, the risk share by the smallholder farmer is more than 10%. Because they were used to savings habit, they can provide 15% up to 20%. So the 90% here is a maximum. In the Mali case, for instance, the input supplier said that I'm okay to share the loan risk with the farmer up to 30%. So it provides 30% of the loan request amount into a deposit account with the bank and then supply them with the input. So the bank put a hold of 30% of his payment and pay him 70%. So it's just a maximum. So depending on the risk shared by the farmer, the off-taker, and the input supplier, at the end of the day, we see the bank, if all of them, for instance, agree of 10% risk sharing, you will see the bank having a deposit account with 30% loan guarantee. And the 70% is on the bank now. In case of default, he's prepared to provide the 70% as provision or rely on other guarantee portfolio to secure this 70%. But at least he has this one there, he can react on it. And if it is 50%, the burden is lower from the bank side, he will only have 50% to make a provision of or to submit to its guarantee portfolio. So it depends on how they are working, how the buyer is seeing the model important for his supply chain, the input supplier and the farmers as well. But they have to agree to share the loan risk. That's why we put some minimum there, 10% per person.
Okay, thank you very much. I hope that helps. One more question from Ones, and I will send you now two questions because the questions are now creeping in a bit. The two questions coming to you, off-takers through cover most of the risks as they are in charge of making payments to the financial institution. What happens in case of crop failure or side selling? I heard a little bit about crop insurance. It would be good to know whether crop insurance is big in the countries we are working with on these case studies. Then the second question from Paul Seward is, what is the minimum size of farmer groups to qualify for a loan? To Aurelia again.
Yes, it's still relating to the model. So as you will see, let me go with the first about the crop failure and the side selling. All is supposed to be discussed here. And in most cases, what we notice, for instance, in Mali, market contracts, what we were able to have, the contracts most of the time is on the volumes. Farmers don't like at all to have a fixed price before the productions. And when you force them to go into in, at the end of the day, you may find them side selling the produce, not going to the buyer, and then the loan can't be paid back. So they agree in the volume and then the market price at the time they are selling the produce. But in other circumstances with the Ghana, where really the value chain was lead for so many times before by the off-taker, they were already benefiting of a higher price in the market, so the price were able to be fixed. And I know that this is our buyer and this is how we are relating with him, we will supply him. So at the beginning, when there is not yet a strong relationship, not yet solid trust between the member, we can advise to have a contract based on the quantity instead of forcing with the price. And as long as they are working together and the trust is built, they can now come in with fixed price contracts and more incentive even for farmer quality, the premium payment on the quality of the product to the farmer to really avoid the side selling of produce at harvest time. The second question, if you can remind me a little bit, Rifaro.
What is the minimum size of the farmer groups that can qualify for a loan?
Thank you very much. What we have experienced, we don't have really a minimum size, but what we work around, some farmer groups are not that much organized than others. You may have farmer groups even with 200 members, very well organized. The banks are able to finance them directly. Then they took the farmer group as an SME and provide one loans. But in case we don't have farmer group that much organized, some have not, sometimes we can find some that not even have a legal name. They are not registered. So how the bank can deal with those people? So what we do is to have small group of 10 people, at least minimum 10 people, going into group lending. And most of the time is with the microfinance institutions and credit union in rural area who can deal with those small group of 10. But a minimum of for bank to enter in, they need to treat the farmer group as an SME with a large numbers of farmer member of membership. I don't know if Edwige or other member of the team has something to add to this question, because it's very important at the implementation stage of the model.
I think, Paul, what I want to say to this is that, I mean, reaching the farmers is mostly done through the buyers and the input suppliers. So it really depends on the number of farmers that they are working with. So if input dealers through VBAs, for example, deliver the inputs, then the farmer group size will be the farmers that are organized by the VBAs, right? If buyers buy from aggregated farmers, then that is the unit that we will work with. So I think it's not so much the bank putting a criteria of how many farmers should be organized in which way. It's more like how do the buyers and the input providers and the VBAs in the middle deal with farmers. Right? And I think VBAs can play an important role to make this whole chain work, right? To get the inputs to the farmers and to get the produce in the right quantity and quality to the buyers is a role where VBAs are very important. I know that's what you wanted to hear, Paul.
Yeah, it's true. It's true.
Thank you.
To add to Onez's question, I think the issue of side selling is also very critical. But one of the experiences that we've had, even with Profit here, was the fact that if you are structuring relationships with a buyer, then you leave for the farmers some room, let's say 30% of their produce, so that you don't structure everything that they are producing to be sold through that structured market. So if you leave them room to have some way of selling those aside, then you dissuade them from side selling, which means that they have option of maybe 30%, which they can sell as they wish, and then they only use like 70 or 60% in a structured market.
Yeah,
thank you.
Very good input.
That's useful.
I think we still had the question on the crop insurance. Yes. Somebody asked about where are we working on crop insurance. I think in Agra it's an underdeveloped area. So I think we need to do more. Currently, we have very active crop insurance schemes in Kenya and we're trying to implement it in Tanzania. And I'm sure maybe in some countries it's more government regulated. But I think it's a topic we need to do more on, especially if we want to make this type of models work. So I think it's for all of us, right? In the policy and state capability team and also in the other technical teams.
Thank you very much. That's useful to know. As a question from Aseta, how do farmer groups do their needs assessments and aggregate these needs? Who is the entry point, the farmer group or the off-taker? Then the second question from Keinde is that what are we doing to help banks better appreciate the business cycle of agriculture? The first question is to Aurelia, the second one is to Hedwig.
Thank you, Rifaro. Maybe I'll start with the question on aggregation of input need, and Hedwig will come back later.
Okay.
It's an important question, Asita, and I think this is also what motivates bank, because at this step, they used to invest a lot when they are not dealing with model like this, to assess the exact need of the farmer and then aggregate this need as a loan appraisal process and all those things. So what we do, normally for a bank to lend, he needs to make analysis of the cash flow of the borrower and have information about it and maybe agree I'll be only financing the 50% of this cash flow or 40% of this cash flow. But with farmer, how they will be able to have this information, they can't. So what we do, we base the loan calculation on the portion the farmer is putting into, is supplying to the market. Because when they produce, for sure, in staple crop value chain, mainly the maize, they have a portion for their own consumptions, and then they have the portion that go to the market. So we use the portion of this market to make the calculation on the input volume. For them to be able to produce it, they need to have this quantity of input again to be able to supply produce in the market. And this is really this portion who secure the payment of the loan, and the bank relief to it is just a calculation method. You may find this process in the guide methodology we develop on the model. and it's very clear and simple to do it. And most of the time, it doesn't require that they are measuring the lawn size, they are going to check on the field, they are going to check household consumption. It will take really time and cost for the banks. So they use the information, market information. They can also have the lawn size information with the buyer and all those fees, and they put them together to have the to design the input lawn size for the farmers.
Thank you.
Edwish, back to you.
Yeah, so what do we do with banks? I think very good question, Kehinde, because most of the banks are not familiar with agriculture and agricultural cycles. So a lot of the defaults, I mean, that's what we found in studies, a lot of the defaults on loans, in agricultural loans, comes from wrong product design by banks as well. Right. So banks disburse loans when it's already too late, for example. And of course, people will start using the money, but they will not invest it in agriculture. Right. If the season, the planting season is over, the bank should not disburse the money, for example. So this type of principles is very important. So that's why our main role as inclusive finance team is to make sure that banks do the right thing. So sometimes we do that through technical assistance contracts. So we hire consultants to help banks to design the right products, to put in place the right procedures, to understand the risk sharing, to understand what type of collateral they would require. So that requires technical assistance. So some of it is done by ourselves, by our team members, and some of it is through external people. And so that's why in most cases, when you put together this type of facilities, you need some type of TA money, either for our own costs or for hiring an expert to help the bank to implement this, right? For them to understand agriculture, because you're very right. Agricultural cycles are very precise. And if you're not in time, then the whole loan cycle will fail. So that is very important. And I think like in profits, we have developed different models, lending models, which are less risky for the banks. And that was done through the hiring of consultants.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I will do the next two questions. One from Daibon. What is the interest rate of the system compared to normal loans? The second one from Esther. The ABP financing most times in Nigeria, it takes long due to bureaucracy and it comes to the farmers late. How do you, in this model, shorten the time before the farmers get the loan? Aurelia, it's still going back to you.
Yes. I think what we observe in the film will surely help to clarify those two questions. So first question about the interest rates. So it depends on the context. In Ghana, what we observe is the bank use the deposit and remunerate the deposit. So instead of, because what the cash collateral offer here is different of the other asset collateral. It's a cash, and when you put the cash with the bank, is supposed to generate interest. So the bank say you have two choices. I will remunerate the savings you are putting there, or I will use this remuneration to lower the interest rate comparing to what you will be receiving in the market. And the off-taker suggests that they remunerate the savings of the farmer to create more incentive and allow more farmers to enter into his supply chain. And then the deposit the off-taker made itself, he asked the bank to use the remuneration on this deposit to lower the interest rate. So they were able to benefit both, I mean, on farmer side, lower interest rates and then savings remunerations. But in Mali, what we have is all of them agree we are not doing these things at the beginning for large profits. So what we suggest is you use all the interest that will be generated on the deposit to lower the interest rate. So we end up with Soro Yiriwaso, who is financing Agric at 12%. They agree to lower the interest rate till 10%. I think Mali people may testify it there in the, if they are in the section, they are attending the webinar. So comparing to what is a microfinance bank, and microfinance bank cost is higher even for what they can receive from a commercial bank, but they were able to lower it 2 points. In Burkina case, we have a DFIs. A DFIs is a bank who has the objective, development objective. So they have already cheaper funds provided by the government of Burkina and also AFDB. So they are already practicing the very lower price. They are at 7.5 per annum, while in the market, the farmer may be receiving 12% with other commercial bank or MFIs. So we were not able to lower it more, but what we do there, we negotiate with the bank because we are reducing your cost of operation. Another cost there the farmer is supposed to pay is the management fees. When you apply for a loan, you pay for a management fees and then you pay also the interest rate into your installment. So they were able to lower, in this case, the management fees. So when we really try to put together the value proposition we are putting on the table from our consortia, when we put it on the table of the bank, they are really flexible to discuss the pricing of their product because they also are benefiting. And the second question is about the bureaucracy of the bank. This is really true, a very big challenge. We faced this challenge with the model in Burkina last year, where the disbursement were done very late. So I think one of part of the answer is already provided through Edwige's answer for the last questions is the TA for the bank is at time very important. It's because the bank that don't know really the know-how lending to agric. It respects a calendar. They need to do things right where it's supposed to be done to be sure that we'll be receiving the good result at the end. And I think the technical assistant is critical at time to help the bank have this knowledge and design the product and also adapt the back office services to the disbursement on time of this produce. And we have it in plan with some of the bank we are working with. And I think if it is needed in any country, it will be very important to have this TA in place to support the model. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think you've answered both questions, right?
Yes, but yeah. Maybe, yeah, thank you.
There's a question from Anonymous. I like the people called Anonymous. How does input finance work in light of subsidized inputs by government? I think that one is for Hedwig. The second one from Kureshi is this improved women youth access to finance? Aurelia, for the second one.
Input finance in the light of subsidies from government. Good question. It really depends how subsidies of governments are structured. What our advice is to advise government to do the subsidization through the banks so that it becomes part and parcel of this scheme. Right. So if we take this scheme as the departure point of how inputs can get to farmers being financed, the subsidy can be used to reduce the outstanding balance with the bank. Or the subsidy can be deposited in the bank as the cash collateral. So I think the subsidy schemes that governments want to put in place for input finance, in fact, we should recommend as AGRA, that's my advice, to do it through this input finance model so that you make sure that farmers repay. Because I saw a question on side selling, and I think the whole idea of the off-taker having put a deposit in the bank as well, make sure that the off-taker monitors the farmers, right? So I would expect off-takers to go to the fields of the farmers, see when the harvest is almost there, and be there when the harvest is ongoing. And that is exactly what we want, right? We want the input dealers and the off-takers to be engaging with the farmers so that they know what's happening. And whether they do that themselves or through the VBAs, that is something we can discuss. But I think the whole idea of all parties taking risk is that they also are involved in the well-being of the production and the off-taking. So it's more closer monitoring, right? It's not sitting in your factory and waiting till the trucks come and bring the produce. It's going to the fields to the farmers, make sure you're there when the harvest is due. So that will prevent side selling.
Okay, our time is almost up. I will send two last questions. Which is the lead institutions driving this model? the bank, the input supplier, the buyer, the farmer group. And the last question, what is the assurance for agriculture production? I think this one was asked before. Okay. So if we can answer those ones, then the rest of the questions can be answered when you share the answers on email.
Okay. Let me maybe jump on the question of the driving institutions. I think the model shows it clearly. If we see a bank open, we can go through the bank. He will be the one driving the institutions. But it's important to have an off-taker because this is where everything starts. The payment of the loan, the guarantee market of the farmer is key. So the model can never be duplicated or implemented somewhere where we don't have this relationship between the off-taker and the farmers. So with the consortia, we use the farmer group as an entry point, but really the person driving the process is the off-taker. We need to share the risk and also provide the market for the farmers. I'll give it back to Edwige if she had things to add to it and conclude. Thank you.
No, I think we have gone through most of the questions. The assurance, the insurance, which I mentioned, right? It is an underdeveloped area, and I think we need to do more. I think AGRA is partnering with Pula and with Eka Africa, which are the two, let's say, most prominent companies promoting agriculture insurance. And I think we need to start working with them in the countries whenever they are there. We should do more on that because it's a crucial element in de-risking agricultural finance. Let me stop here, Rufaro.
Yes, our time is really, really up, but I am so interested in hearing answers to just two more questions. How long does it take for this model to be self-sustainable from IPIANA? And the smallholder farmers could be receiving money from different sources. How do we guard from this double or triple dipping by smallholder farmers? Then we close it after this. I think, Edric.
The self-sustaining, it is self-sustaining, right? There is nothing. I mean, the only thing that AGRA needs to pay for is to make this system work. So that's why we said we can build it on the consortium model, because we have already invested in building those linkages and building those agribusiness platforms. But the scheme itself, the financing is self-sustainable, right? There's no subsidies or anything. So that is the beauty of the system. So it can be replicated all over the place. If we in AGRA, all of us listening, are going to promote from tomorrow on this model, then we can make it very big. And it's already self-sustaining. So we should use the investments we have already made in the consortia to make this work. The smallholder farmers triple dipping, I think what Aurelia explained is that the credits will be given in kind, so it will be inputs. So yeah, if farmers want to buy 3 packs of seed instead of 1, I think that's not something we have a problem with, right? So I think the risk, the de-risking of farmers double dipping or triple dipping is reduced by giving them the inputs and not giving them the cash.
Thank you so much for this presentation. It's been an eye-opener. I will just ask the presenters to give closing remarks in 1 minute, and then we close. The other questions that were not answered, you will receive the answers on email. Thank you, presenters. Oh, now 1-2 minutes to close.
Okay, let me start and Edwige will now completely conclude. So I just want to thank all the colleagues that attend this webinar. It's a great opportunity for us to share what the IF team is doing in the field regarding the input finance. And I will ask that we put all our effort together to really make the system work, because it's really a change we are introducing in how smallholder will do business, or the value chain is supposed to do business in the field. And I will just encourage each of us and hope I will see some of you very soon in the field to support the implementation of the model, to have ideas from you, and also help us to select partners that can make this work in the field. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to start, Leah, in thanking you for listening to us. And I think this is a practical implementation of what was presented in the last webinar of making farmers thinking commercially. I think we start by the market party and farmers producing for markets, otherwise they cannot get access to finance. I think that should be the lesson on the basics. And as said, I invite all of you to now go back and rethink on your consortia and tell us where you think we could be implementing this, because we have this put in our diaries and agendas to make this input finance model working in other countries. So please come back to us and tell us where you want us to come and help you implement this schedule. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, everyone, for joining in this webinar, and thank you for listening. Sorry for going over time by a few minutes, but we hope you were thoroughly interested. Enjoy your afternoon and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you.